Have you ever tried transferring your old videotapes to your computer using a capture device? You may have experienced the frustration of the capture device freezing up during the process, dropped frames, a jumpy, unstable picture, or the video and sound going out of sync.
Welcome to my lovely basement TV studio where VHS technology is still alive and well.
Especially on long captures. So why does this happen? To understand this, let's talk about how a VCR works. Videotape machines have the video pickup heads on a rotating drum. Each time the heads make a full rotation, it records, or plays back, a frame of video. Each frame is made up of individual scan lines. Embedded in the video information are signals or codes which tell the playback devices when one scan line ends and the next scan line begins. At the bottom of the videotape is what's known as the control track, which contains tracking information. You want the video heads to line up with the scan patterns on the tape. If they don't line up, the picture may look snowy and distorted because the heads aren't properly in line with the information on the tape. By adjusting the tracking, the speed of the drum will speed up or slow down ever so slightly so that the heads scan the tape at the right moment. Because tape recorders are mechanical, they have inconsistencies in their speed. This is called wow and flutter. These inconsistencies can vary quite a bit from one machine to the next, but all machines have this problem to some degree. The motors, capstans, and rollers don't consistently move at a precise speed. These imperfections are usually very slight. They're not usually a huge deal when working with audio, but with video, it can be a big deal. If the video heads or tape aren't moving at a constant, precise speed, and it's not, sometimes when playing back the recordings, the video information is played back at the wrong time. And here's what happens. Now let's say, for example, that the first bit of information arrives when it's supposed to. Now let's say the speed of the heads or tape changes just a bit. The next bit of video information might arrive at a slightly different time than the information right before it. Sometimes the signal arrives spot on, sometimes it's early, sometimes it's late. When this happens, the scan lines in the video don't line up precisely. And therein is the problem. They can sometimes look jagged or fuzzy. Also, delays in the color signal can cause imperfections as well. Now, if the fluctuations are bad enough, it can cause the picture to jitter and roll. And many capture devices out there will go completely bonkers when that happens, and sometimes to the point where the capture device just simply crashes and stops working. That's a big problem. Nobody likes that. In addition to wow and flutter, another problem with videotape technology is that the tape itself can stretch or shrink under different temperatures. It can also become wrinkled, scratched, or damaged. Some of you might remember the days when you would go to the neighborhood video store and pick out your favorite videos to rent. You'd take the tapes home, put them in your VCR, hit play, only to find out that the picture quality looks absolutely terrible. And this is often because the tapes have been played on, they've been played many, many times, and probably played on very dirty machines. Dirty tape heads, guides, or rollers in a VCR can cause wrinkles and scratches on the tape. When you play a tape that has a crease in it, you're probably going to get a horizontal line in the picture somewhere. Also, did you know that putting your VCR in pause can sometimes damage the tape as well? Yep. Sometimes pausing the tape will put a slight ding or dent in the tape, so it's best to avoid using pause if you can possibly help it. Most TVs have circuitry to compensate for timing errors. Some TVs handle the imperfections better than others, but there comes a point when the timing, if it's too far off, or if the tape is really damaged, the TV simply cannot correct the problem, and then you get a distorted picture. You won't always notice these problems on a standard TV unless the tape is really, really bad, but on a broadcast monitor, such as this one, there's a mode you can switch to, which allows you to see parts of the picture you wouldn't ordinarily see. Let me show you. See that black line that's bending back and forth? This is because of the imperfections in the timing. the lines in the picture aren't being drawn at the exact expected time each and every time. Sometimes they're early, sometimes they're late. So TVs can often compensate for these timing errors and imperfections. But guess what? Most capture cards aren't nearly as forgiving. Capture devices are picky, and they expect a video signal to be there at a precise time. If the signal is missing, if it's early or late, the capture card might think,
"Say, what's going on around here? What's up, big eyes here?"
And the frame might get dropped. If it drops too many frames, sometimes the capture card just says, "That's it. I'm not doing this anymore. I quit." Now, suppose your capture card drops some video frames but continues capturing the audio. Do you see a problem? That split-second interruption where there's no video signal will often cause the sound and picture to go out of sync. And the more frames that get dropped, the more the sound and picture can drift out of sync. This is particularly noticeable on longer video clips. It can be really frustrating when that happens. And that, my friends, is why you need a device called a Time Base Corrector if you intend to capture videotapes to a computer the right way. A Time Base Corrector, or TBC for short, is a gadget that takes a video signal and literally rebuilds it. It gives it a fresh new sync signal, guaranteeing that each scan line in the picture gets displayed at the proper time. This means fewer jagged vertical edges, no more jumpy picture. And this ensures that your capture device will receive a constant, stable signal. Every frame contains the video information at the time it is expected to be there. Additionally, some time-based correctors have some cool features. Some of the professional-grade ones have what's called a proc amp or color processor, and that allows you to adjust the brightness, contrast, color, and hue or tint. How cool is that? So that means if you've got a video that was recorded with bad lighting, or maybe somebody forgot to white balance the camera, you can make some adjustments to the color before you actually capture it. Some TBCs will allow you to freeze frame a video and produce a rock-solid still image, which would be way better than using the pause feature on your VCR. Some TBCs have what's called dropout compensation, or DOC. How this works is the TBC will store a few lines or complete frames in the memory. If it detects missing video, such as a scratch in the picture, it will insert the stored information so that you don't notice that white speck or scratch where the video is missing. And this is happening in milliseconds. It's constantly grabbing information, storing lines or frames over and over for just seconds at a time, and then releasing them. How well the TBC does this can vary from one machine to the next. Next, I'm going to show you some before and after footage. Here we can see video that was not captured going through the time-base corrector. And you can see that the vertical lines are jagged and distorted. Now here's that same video going through the time-base corrector. And you can see that it made quite a difference. The lines are much straighter. Now, one thing I should point out, though, is let's say that you have an original videotape that's in pretty bad shape to begin with, and then you decide to make a copy of it without going through a time-base corrector. Now let's say that you take that copy and you try to run it through the time-base corrector. What's going to happen? Is the TBC going to clean it up? It might to a degree, but it's not going to do an exceptional job. And the reason for that is because the copy you made is basically like taking a photograph of a building that's on fire. You can't put the fire out by aiming an extinguisher at a photograph. You've got to go to the actual building and put the fire out. So when copying tapes, you want to be as close to the original as you can and run it through the time-based corrector to get the best results. So, where do you get a TBC from? I bought mine from eBay, but there are quite a few companies out there that will sell them brand new. Some are better than others. If you decide to buy a used one, I recommend that you go with one that's digital. You certainly don't want to buy one that's older than your great-grandmother and takes up an entire room. And they used to be that size way back in the day. I think the first time-based corrector was made by a company called Ampex. And that thing was a monster. But it did the trick. It's since gotten much, much smaller. So if you buy a used one, such as off of eBay, you want to look for something that's been tested or has a return policy if it doesn't work. Also, be sure to check out the seller's comments about the seller. Make sure that he or she is reputable. So anyway, that's it. Hopefully you've found this information to be helpful and informative. Thank you for watching. If you are interested in the I.den IVT7 time-based corrector, which is the one that I have, keep watching because I'm going to talk about that. Thank you. One of my hobbies is video production. I sometimes work with old school equipment such as VCRs and camcorders. To copy videotapes to the computer the right way, I use a gadget called a time base corrector. Sometimes these are called T.B.C.s for short. And I bought this particular one off of eBay a couple of years ago. This is the I.den IVT-7 digital time base corrector, sometimes called T.B.C. for short. And when these were brand new, they sold for thousands of dollars, and they were normally found in TV stations and video production houses. But now that most people have gone digital, you can find these things used on eBay pretty cheap. I paid about $200 for this particular one. I did some looking around, and I cannot find an owner's manual for this one anywhere. I don't know what happened to this company, but the manuals seem to be non-existent. Also, I haven't seen any other YouTube videos out there where someone really goes into any detail about this particular time-based corrector. So I thought I'd make one myself. As Ben Stein would say, stick around. You might learn something. I don't claim to be an expert on TBCs. But for what it's worth, we'll talk about this particular gadget, what I know about it, and we'll go over the connections, buttons, knobs, and switches. So on the front, we have a Genlock indicator light, a light for which video input we're using, whether it's YC, which is also known as S-video, or standard video, and whether or not we're using the remote control. Now, I have yet to see a remote control for this unit, but apparently they used to make them. Anyway, the Genlock indicator will come on if you have something plugged into the Genlock inputs on the back. So what is Genlock? Genlock is like a master clock signal. It is the boss, and all the other equipment that connects to it will match the timing of their signal to it. Now, have you ever noticed when you switch your TV, especially the old school TVs, when you switch them from one video source to another, you'll see the picture jump and roll for just a second. This is because the video signals are not perfectly timed with each other. One station has a timing different than the other. And so when you switch from one channel to the other, the picture will jump or roll for just a second. If the signals were perfectly genlocked together, then their timing would match perfectly, and then when you change from one channel to the next, everything would be smooth, and you wouldn't see the picture jump or roll or snow for just a second. Genlock is used in TV studios to allow smooth switching between cameras and VCRs. Without Genlock, if you were to try to superimpose two video signals together or try to switch between one signal to the next, the picture would jump and be distorted for a second or two while it tries to sync back up. But for capturing video and video editing, you're probably not going to use the Genlock feature. But it's there if you ever wanted to sync a couple of cameras together, analog cameras. Okay, so this TBC has two video inputs, one for standard composite video, which is found on most home VCRs, And it's got an input for YC, which is also known as S-Video for some of the higher-end VCRs. S-Video will give you a slightly better signal than composite, but like I said, most home VCRs are composite. And there's an itty-bitty switch behind the front panel that will allow you to select which input you want to use. I have mine set to composite, and so the corresponding indicator light comes on the front telling me which input I'm using. Okay, if you had a remote control plugged in, and if you had the switch behind the front panel set to use the remote, then that's when the remote control light will come on. Now, since I don't have a remote, obviously this light's going to stay off. Okay, moving over to the right, we have three switches with indicator lights. There's one for bypass, freeze frame, or I should say frame freeze, and field freeze. I'm missing the button for bypass, but it still works if I was to use the pencil to press the button. When the bypass button is pressed, the video input just goes straight through the unit without doing any processing. Now, with this particular T.B.C., the unit must be powered on for the bypass switch to work. If the switch is off, you get nothing on the output. But because I want my video to be processed by the T.B.C., I don't use the bypass button at all. Okay, field freeze and frame freeze. Now, television signals have two fields, so when it draws the picture, it will draw field one first, which from top to bottom, which is half of the picture, and then it goes back to the top and fills in between the first field, and that would be the second field. I believe when you do the freeze capture, the field freeze capture, I believe it captures field one, but I could be mistaken. There may also be a setting or switch somewhere that tells it which field to freeze, but I don't really know. But that's what field capture does. It captures one of the two fields and freezes it, just like putting your VCR on pause. Now, frame capture, I believe that captures both fields and probably gives you a much cleaner picture. And again, it's a rock solid, noise-free, still picture. It's like putting your VCR on pause, except much safer. I don't use the freeze features on here, but it's nice if I ever wanted to. Okay, now as you can see, that my particular T.B.C. has a few battle wounds. It's got a small dent in the front from the great earthquake of Salt Lake City, and that happened on March 18th of 2020. When the earthquake hit, it rattled the place. I mean, it really did a number. My shelves collapsed, equipment went all over the room, but the T.B.C. still works. It's no worse for the wear. These things, I got to tell you, they are built to take quite the beating. And they have to be robust because these things used to be mounted in the back of equipment trucks for TV stations. And, you know, they get a lot of abuse. So they are built rock solid. And that's probably also why they were so expensive when they were brand new. Okay, well, that's the front panel. Let's look at the back. And I'll talk about the controls behind the panel here in a minute. So on the back, I'm not going to turn my particular Time Base Corrector around and disconnect everything. So we're using a stock photo here, but this is the same model as what I have. Now, as you can see, there's a lot of BNC connectors back here. I don't have any BNC cables, and so I bought a bunch of BNC to RCA female connectors. You can buy those on Amazon. And that allows me to use standard RCA patch cords, which I already have. I've got tons of those. Okay, so starting on the left, we have a jack for the remote control. I don't have a remote for this. I don't know where you'd find one, so I don't use this jack. Next, we've got two composite video outputs. This is just standard video out. I like the fact that there's two of them. I can send one signal to my monitor. I can send the other one to the capture card. There's only one S-Video output, though. Okay, next is what's called BB out. And BB, if I'm not mistaken, means black burst. Now, I don't know a ton about black burst, but as I understand it, it outputs a reference signal that other video equipment can compare to. For video editing and capturing, you're not going to use this feature. That would normally be used if you've got a video switcher or you're in a TV station and you need something that generates a black signal. I believe that's when you're going to use that. Okay, next is RFN, and I believe what that means is reference video in. And what I think this is for is if you've got some other device that is acting as the master clock or the boss, you can sync the time-based corrector against it. And so the time-based corrector would match its timing to an external source. I believe that's what the reference video in is. For video editing and dubbing tapes, you're not going to use this. Okay, so moving on, we've got two Genlock inputs. And as I mentioned earlier, the Genlock is used to synchronize other video equipment together. For video editing and dubbing tapes, you're probably not going to use these. So, you know, they're there. But for what I use this thing for, I don't use these inputs. Okay. Next is composite video in. This is just standard video in from your VCR. And then we have S video in, sometimes called YC. And we also have an old school YC connector. Some of the old ginormous bulky professional VCRs used to have connectors like this instead of the standard S video. Technology is the same, just different type of connector. And I mean, we're talking equipment that goes back many, many years, and those things were the size of a tank and probably weighed over 50 pounds. You probably won't find a lot of equipment now that has this type of connector. That's what that's for. Okay, so I use composite video in and out jack. Yeah, I don't know if this unit will convert composite video to S video. In other words, if you feed standard video in, will it output on S video? I don't know. I've not tried that. I probably should try that and find out. Anyway, next to that, we have a grounding terminal. This is if it was placed in a studio equipment rack, you can ground it. Let's see. Then we have the standard power connector, which just uses a standard computer power cord, and then the fan. One thing I got to tell you is the fan is pretty noisy on this thing. But if you've ever toured a TV station and you go to the back of their control room where they've got all these things, they're noisy. They're really noisy with all that equipment because it can get warm with everything running. So they've got to have fans to cool them down. Okay, one thing I don't particularly like about the I.den IVT7 is all of the controls are hidden behind the front panel. I kind of wish the power switch was out in the front, but I can kind of understand why they put the controls behind the panel. It's to prevent people from bumping or tampering with them. So, the front panel opens down like this. Okay, and we've got the power switch on the left. Now, I've removed the audio from this video because of the noisy fan, but trust me when I say that the unit's a little bit noisy. Okay, now there's several adjustments and knobs behind this panel, which you probably shouldn't touch, all right? And they are the ones that are colored yellow and blue. They take a small jewelry-type screwdriver to adjust. You want to leave those alone. The only time you should adjust any of those yellow and blue controls is if you're trying to synchronize multiple video sources together. And if you've got the proper equipment to do it, like scopes and basically if you're a broadcast engineer, I guess. But, you know, unless you really know what you're doing, you probably don't want to mess with anything that is blue and yellow. Leave those alone. Okay, there's two circuit boards in here. And we'll start with the top board and talk about the switches and the controls. First, we have an impedance switch, which will switch between high or 75 ohms. I leave mine set to 75, which is what most consumer grade equipment uses. Okay, next we have the video level and setup controls. Now, you'll see that these knobs are black and these are adjustments that are safe to make. You can adjust these. They're part of what's called the processor or proc amp. So you can adjust the brightness and contrast with these two controls. We'll talk a little bit more about those in a bit. Okay. Next is the video source input switch. I talked about this a little bit ago. This determines if we're going to use the composite video input or if we're using the S-Video or YC input. Okay, I have mine set to composite video, and the light on the front panel comes on and says video, which is composite. Okay, next is the invert switch. Now, I don't have any idea what this switch does. I'm guessing maybe it determines when you hit the freeze frame, the field frame, maybe it determines which field is scanned first, field one or field two. I don't really know. But I have mine set to the off position, and you'll probably want to leave this switch alone. Okay, next is the local or remote switch. And as I don't have a remote control for the time-based corrector, I set this to local and leave it alone. And so the remote indicator light on the front panel will stay off. Okay, next we have SC. This means sub-carrier phase. Okay, color phase. It's used to match the timing of the color signal against other equipment. And as you can see, it's blue and yellow. And so unless you're a broadcast engineer or really know what you're doing, you're going to want to leave this control alone. Okay. Next, we have two adjustments for mod balance, and I have absolutely no idea what these do. As they're blue and yellow, we're going to leave these alone. Okay, next is the burst level. This has something to do with the color signal and timing. Again, it's blue and yellow, so we're going to leave that one alone. These larger black knobs, as I said, are adjustments that you, the operator, can make. The black knobs are the proc amp settings. Okay, they allow you to adjust the brightness, the contrast, and so on. You can adjust these if you want. And you'll always want to start with the black level or the setup first and then go from there. Okay, so starting on the left, we've got the video level and then the black or brightness level. Over here, we've got the chroma phase, and this is sometimes known as the tint or hue control. Okay, the chroma level or color saturation, all right, pretty similar to what you'd see on the old school TV sets. Okay, and then you've got the signal out adjustment, and you can adjust that if you want, if you find that the overall signal is too low or too high. Okay, now to the bottom board. There is a video and H phase, horizontal phase adjustment, along with a YC delay. Again, these are blue and yellow, and so, like I said, unless you've got scopes and are a broadcast engineer, which I am not, we're going to leave these alone. Okay, and now we have the dock switch. Now, dock means dropout compensation. Now, this is kind of a cool feature. I could be wrong about how this works, but as I understand it, the time-based corrector stores lines or frames of video into memory for just milliseconds at a time and then releases over and over and over. And what this will do, supposedly, is if your video signal is missing information, let's say you've got a scratch on the tape, normally you're going to see a white speck on your video. But what the dropout compensation will do is if it detects a hole in the picture, so to speak, it's going to fill that hole with stored information so that you don't see that speck on the video. At least I believe that's what dock does. Now, it's not perfect. It doesn't fill every little flaw in, but it does a pretty nice job in cleaning up the picture. So it is a nice feature to have, and some time-based correctors do this better than others. This one does a pretty good job, I guess. Anyway, I've got my dropout compensation switch set to on. And then lastly, there's a VBLK switch, and I believe this stands for video blanking. I'm not sure what this does, so we'll leave it alone. I have mine set to on. Okay, for video capturing and editing, the T.B.C. is this particular one is really easy to connect and use. You simply run either composite or video from your VCR's output to the appropriate input on the T.B.C. and then make sure that the input switch behind the front panel is set to, set accordingly, either video or YC, S video. And of course, the indicator light on the front will show you which one you've got it set to. And then you connect the output over to your capture device. And you can run another output to your monitor if you want. And then, before starting your video capture, you want to press play for a minute on your VCR. And then you can adjust, if you want to, you can adjust the proc amp settings for the picture, set up your black level, your color levels, and so on. And once you've got the picture quality the way you want it, as far as brightness, color, and so on, then rewind your tape, press play, and then when you get a stable picture, then you can start your capture. And that's basically it. So, while this video doesn't tell you every little thing there is to know about the I.den IVT digital time-based corrector, I hope it at least tells you something about it. Like I said, there was no information out there anywhere about this. Somebody needed to make a video about it, so it might as well be me. So hopefully you found this somewhat informative, and I thank you for watching.